Hello everybody, welcome back. Today in this video we'll be discussing about environmental chemistry. Fine. So in this chapter we'll be mainly focusing on environmental pollution. We know that there are various types of environmental pollutions, right? And the substance which causes the pollution are called pollutants. Fine. Pollutants are usually like solid, liquid or gases, whatever, which is present in a higher concentration than it's actually required. Fine. And these causes effects in human beings, plants and animals. That is, it causes effects to the environment around it. Fine. And environmental pollution has various types of pollutions like air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution, noise pollution, etc. But in this chapter, we'll be mainly focusing on air pollution, that is atmospheric pollution. Fine. And then water pollution and solid pollution. And few measures which people have come up with to control the pollution. Fine. So moving ahead, first is the atmospheric pollution. You know what is atmosphere, right? This whatever we are surrounded with is atmosphere, right? And the Earth's atmosphere is not uniform throughout, right? It has different layers. It has like different concentrations, and all these layers are not of same thickness, right? And hence they are not of the same density. Fine, they're in the form of layers around the Earth. Fine, and the layer, the lowest region of the atmosphere is called the troposphere. This is basically the region where we all live in. Fine, troposphere consists of air, water vapor, and clouds. Fine, the clouds formation all happens in the troposphere. So this is basically at least 10 kilometers above the sea level. Fine, and then the next region after the troposphere comes the stratosphere. Stratosphere is around like 10 to 50 kilometers above the sea level. Fine. It extends from 10 kilometers to 50 kilometers. Fine. And troposphere, stratosphere consists of dinitrogen, dioxygen, ozone, a little bit of water vapor as well. So when we talk about atmospheric pollution, we talk about tropospheric pollution and stratospheric pollution as well. And also, stratosphere consists of something known as ozone, that is the molecule O3. And this ozone layer is so important that it blocks almost 99.5% of the sun's harmful UV radiation and prevents it from reaching the Earth's surface. And now we'll discuss about all of this in detail. Fine. First up, atmospheric pollution. So the tropospheric pollution is divided as gaseous air pollutants and the particulate pollutants. So the pollutants causing the tropospheric pollutions are basically divided into two different categories, right? And under the gaseous air pollutants, we have oxides of sulfur, nitrogen, carbon, that is carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, and hydrocarbons. And then we have hydrogen sulfide and ozone. These are all the gaseous air pollutants when we talk about tropospheric pollution. Fine. And when we talk about particulate pollutions, we have dust, then comes fumes, then mist, then smoke, and then smog. These are all the particulate pollutants. So now we'll discuss about all of this in a little bit in detail. Fine. So first up, gaseous air pollutants. First, we'll talk about the oxides of sulfur. These oxides of sulfur are produced when sulfur containing fossil fuels are burned. Fine. So when the fossil fuels which contain sulfur are burned, the oxides of sulfur are formed. Fine. And these oxides of sulfur are very harmful for human beings, plants and animals. Fine. So even the low concentration of sulfur dioxide can cause respiratory diseases in human beings like asthma, bronchiotis, emphysema, etc. And it causes irritation to the eyes and it results in tears and redness of the eye. Fine. And this is about the low concentrations of sulfur dioxide. When the sulfur dioxide is in high concentration, it causes stiffness of the flower buds which eventually fall off from the plants. Hence, we saw how it's affecting the human, animal and the plants as well, right? So what happens is the reaction, which basically happens is in sulfur dioxide, this is the pollutant, right? When the sulfur dioxide reacts with the air around us, right? In troposphere, there is oxygen, right? When this oxygen readily reacts with sulfur dioxide, we get sulfur trioxide, fine? And the sulfur dioxide and reacting with the ozone gives sulfur trioxide as well, fine? And the sulfur dioxide, when it reacts with hydrogen peroxide, that is H2O2, it gives sulfuric acid, which is actually aqueous, fine? So this sulfuric acid is very harmful, and we'll discuss about this when we talk about acid rain, fine? When the sulfur trioxide and hydrogen peroxide combine, they form sulfuric acid. Sometimes it comes down to the form to the earth in the form of acid rain, and it's very harmful. Fine, we'll discuss about this a little bit later. Fine. Next gaseous air pollutant we'll be discussing is the oxides of nitrogen. Fine. So there are two types of oxides of nitrogen, that is nitric oxide and nitrogen dioxide. Fine. When nitrogen and oxygen, these two are present in the atmosphere, right? That is, they're present in the dinitrogen, dioxygen, where did we discuss? Stratosphere, right? So these two are present in the atmosphere, but under normal conditions, they do not combine, fine? They do not react. But what happens is when lightning strikes, this dinitrogen and dioxygen, they react and they form nitric oxide, fine? Under normal conditions, they are not reactive, fine? When lightning strikes or such time, under such conditions, these two react and form nitric oxide, fine? And this nitric oxide instantly reacts with the atmospheric oxygen, that is O2, and forms nitrogen dioxide. And also, this nitric oxide reacts with the ozone and forms nitrogen dioxide as well. But this reaction, that is nitric oxide reacting with the ozone, it's faster. The rate of the formation of nitrogen dioxide from ozone is faster compared to the rate of formation of the nitrogen dioxide when the nitric oxide combines with oxygen, fine. So this is what happens when nitric oxide is formed and it combines with either oxygen, that is O2 molecule, or ozone, fine. It forms nitrogen dioxide and it is harmful as well. The higher concentration of NO2 damages the plants and it retards the rate of photosynthesis, fine. This is how it's damaging the plant life, fine. And for when you talk about its effects on human beings and animals, it is a lung irritant. And it causes acute respiratory diseases in children, fine? And it is toxic to living tissues as well. And it is harmful to various textile fibers and metals, etc. Fine? This is all about the oxides of nitrogen. Moving ahead, next we'll discuss about hydrocarbons, fine? Hydrocarbons are basically formed because of carbon and hydrogen, fine? These two are the main elements forming the hydrocarbons, fine? And these are formed due to incomplete combustion of fuels used in automobiles, fine? So when the fuels in the automobile undergo incomplete combustion, hydrocarbons are released to the atmosphere, and hydrocarbons are dangerous as well. They are carcinogenic, which means they cause cancer, fine? And they're harmful for plants also. And what they do is they break down the tissues and they shed the leaves, flowers and twigs as well. Fine. So this is all about hydrocarbons and how they are dangerous to us and how they come into atmosphere. Fine. Next is the oxides of carbon. So oxides of carbon, there are two types. The first one we'll be discussing about carbon monoxide, that is C-O bond, C triple bond O. Fine. This carbon monoxide is a colorless and odorless gas, fine, and it is produced as a result of incomplete combustion of carbon. So now we know how carbon monoxide is got, right? When there is an incomplete combustion of carbon, carbon monoxide is released, fine, and it's basically released from automobile exhaust or incomplete combustion of coal, firewood and petrol, fine, and this carbon monoxide is so much poisonous. I think you all have heard about carbon monoxide poisoning, right? It is poisonous to living beings. What it does is it blocks the delivery of oxygen to organs and tissues. You all know how important oxygen is for the human body, right? We cannot survive without oxygen. We breathe in oxygen and then it gets transferred to all the organs and tissues. And this carbon monoxide just blocks the delivery of oxygen to organs and tissues, fine? And what actually happens is, when carbon monoxide combines with hemoglobin, we have hemoglobin present in our blood, right? So carbon monoxide combines with hemoglobin and forms carboxyhemoglobin. And this carboxyhemoglobin is more stable than oxygen hemoglobin complex. It is about 300 times more stable than the oxygen hemoglobin complex. And hence it forms very easily, fine? And in blood, when the concentration of carboxyhemoglobin reaches around 3 to 4 times 4%, and the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood is greatly reduced. So in that case, the blood can't carry oxygen, right? So oxygen is not delivered to tissues and organs. So what happens is this carboxyhemoglobin level has increased, and it's degrading the capacity of the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, and hence this causes a lot of symptoms like headache, nausea, dizziness, breathlessness, people collapse also. It can cause loss of consciousness as well. And hence that is why people say do not smoke, because smoking also, what happens during smoking is because of the income, if there is an incomplete combustion of carbon, it is carcinogenic, right? That is why they say smoking is cancer, smoking is dangerous to health because it causes cancer, fine? And especially it is highly instructed to the pregnant women not to smoke, because smoking is very, very dangerous for pregnant women. In pregnant, if the pregnant women smoke, there's an increased level of carbon monoxide in the blood, which may induce premature birth or spontaneous abortion, or it can even deform the babies. Fine. So now you know how poisonous carbon monoxide is, right? And this carbon monoxide is one of the gaseous air pollutants. Next oxide of carbon is carbon dioxide. We discussed about carbon monoxide, that is CO, and now we'll discuss about carbon dioxide, that is CO2. The molecule looks something like this: carbon doubly bonded to two oxygen atoms. Fine. And this carbon dioxide is released into the atmosphere via respiration, right? We take in oxygen and give out carbon dioxide. This is one way of releasing carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. The second one is the burning of fossil fuels for energy. Fine. And the third one, carbon dioxide is released when limestone is decomposed during the manufacture of cement. Fine. And the next one is it's emitted to the atmosphere when there is a volcanic eruption. Fine. These are the four main methods. One is through respiration. Second is when you burn the fossil fuels. Third one is during the manufacture of cement when limestone decomposes. And the fourth one is it's emitted during the volcanic eruptions. And this carbon dioxide, when there is an increased amount of carbon dioxide in the air, it leads to something known as global warming. Fine. When this carbon dioxide is more than the required amount in the air, this causes global warming. What happens during global warming is gases like carbon dioxide, methane, chlorofluorocarbons, etc., all these are in the increasing amount, and they get trapped in between the earth and the atmosphere, and this increases the temperature between the earth and the atmosphere, right? So now we'll discuss about the global warming and the greenhouse effect. So during global warming, what basically happens is carbon dioxide traps the heat, and this leads to the rise in the earth's temperature, which is known as global warming. So usually earth receives around 75% of the sun's rays, right? Sun's heat. And few of the heat has been radiated back, and few have been absorbed. And you can see this video. This is from NASA, where you'll clearly understand the greenhouse effect. Fine. So what happens is when sunlight reaches the earth, few of the energy has been reflected back into the space, whereas some of it is absorbed and re-radiated as heat. And this heat is being absorbed by the greenhouse gases and reflected in all the directions. And hence, this causes the warming of the earth. That is, it increases the temperature of the earth. And this is what is about greenhouse effect and the global warming. Fine. Now, let us discuss about something known as acid rain. Fine. This, when the rainwater, the normal rainwater, whatever comes down when there's a rain, has pH of 5.6. Due to the presence of H plus ions formed by the reaction of rainwater with carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere. Fine. So it has a pH of 5.6 because it has a presence of H plus ion, which is acidic, right? Which is formed when rainwater reacts with the carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere. But when this pH drops below 5.6, the rainwater is said to be acidic. We know the scale, right? Acidic is less than 7, right? And below 5.6 is highly acidic, right? So when the pH of rainwater drops below 5.6, it is called acid rain. So what happens is basically these pollutants, whatever we discuss now, like carbon dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, and sulfur dioxide, are emitted from industries, and these automobiles and the electricity, other industries as well, these go to the atmosphere, combine and come down to earth in the form of acid rain, and this is very harmful for us. So the reactions what's basically happening is water. Water combines with the carbon dioxide and forms H2CO3, which is what gives the H plus ion, and because of that we get the pH of rainwater as 5.6, right? When sulfur dioxide combines with the atmospheric oxygen and water, that is rainwater, it forms sulfuric acid. We all know how harmful sulfuric acid is, right? And not only sulfuric acid, when nitrogen dioxide reacts with the oxygen present in the air and water, it forms nitric acid, fine? Even we know how dangerous nitric acid is, fine? Both are acids and they're highly dangerous, both sulfuric acid and nitric acid, right? And let us see how harmful they are. We'll discuss about the few of them, fine? It is harmful for the agriculture, trees and plants, right? Acid rains, when it falls on the crops, it is harmful for all the crops, right? Because it is acidic. And it causes respiratory ailments in human beings and animals. Yes, because we breathe in, and when there's all these chemicals present in the oxygen, it causes the respiratory ailments. Fine. It affects plants, aquatic life as well. And it corrodes water pipes. Because of the presence of these chemicals, there is a corrosion in the water pipes. Because this water goes into the pipes, right? And it damages the buildings. For example, Taj Mahal, India. In India is the best example of how it's affected by acid rain, right? It's damaged because of the acid rain, and it also damages the structures made of stone or metal. Fine, this is all about the acid rains. Moving ahead, until now we discussed about the gaseous air pollutants. Now we'll discuss about the particulate matter. Fine, the first one is smoke. Smoke is basically solid or a mixture of solid and liquid particles. Fine. And they're formed during combustion of organic matter. Like, for example, smoke from cigarettes. Cigarette contains organic matter inside it, fine? It's organic chemistry. We discussed about tobacco, right? And burning of fossil fuels, the garbage and dry leaves. When you burn this garbage and dry leaves, you know, there comes smoke out of it, right? That is nothing but organic matter only. And then oil smoke, etc. This is about the smoke. And when we discuss about dust, dust is composed of fine particles. We know how dust looks like, right? And these fine particles are almost over 1 micrometer in diameter. They're so small. And they're produced during crushing, grinding, or attribution of solid materials. We know how dust is formed everywhere, right? And for example, sand from sand blasting, cement dust, and fly ash from the factories, dust storms, etc. Fine, this is all about dust. Moving ahead, mist. Particles of spray liquids and by condensation of vapors in air causes mist. Fine, mist is produced by the particles. When you spray liquids, right, we get mist out of it. And it's by the condensation of vapors in air. For example, sulfuric acid mist, herbicides, insecticides. We spray insecticides, right, so that it prevents insects from, for the plants, we spray pesticides. These are all forms mist. Fine. Next is fumes. When fumes are produced, that is formed when condensation of vapor during sublimation, distillation, boiling, or other chemical reaction. So when there's a condensation of vapor during all this process, like sublimation, distillation, during boiling and other chemical reactions, fumes are formed. Fine. For examples, organic solvents, metal and metallic oxides form fume particles. Fine. And there is one more particulate matter known as smog. We'll discuss a little bit more in detail about smog now. Fine. Smog is nothing but smoke plus fog. Fine. Smoke, when it combines with fog, it forms something known as smog. And smog is further divided as classical smog and photochemical smog. So what's classical smog and what all comes under photochemical smog? Let us see. So classical smog basically happens when the cold and humid climate. Fine. And it is a mixture of smoke, fog and sulfur dioxide. Fine. This is also pollutant now. And it is chemically, it is a reducing mixture. Hence we call it as reducing smog. Fine. And when we talk about photochemical smog, it happens during warm, dry and sunny climate. Fine. And it is due to the action of sunlight on unsaturated hydrocarbons and nitrogen dioxide. And again, here we see hydrocarbons, nitrogen dioxide. In case of classical smog, we saw sulfur dioxide, right? And it has high concentration of oxidizing agents, and hence we call it as oxidizing smog. Fine. Moving ahead, let us discuss about the photochemical smog a little bit more. Fine. So this photochemical smog, as you can see in the diagram, it is formed when nitrogen dioxide, that is the gas, it gets some heat radiation from the sun. Fine. When the energy from the heat radiations from the sun strike the nitrogen dioxide, it forms nitric oxide and O, oxygen, which is a gas. Fine. So what happens further? This nitric, when nitrogen dioxide has when the heat from the sun strikes the nitrogen dioxide, it forms nitric oxide and oxygen. So this oxygen combines with a molecule of oxygen, that is O2, and forms O3, that is nothing but ozone. Fine. And this ozone combines with the nitric oxide and forms nitrogen dioxide and O2, that is oxygen molecule. Fine. And now CH4 is nothing but methane. Fine. When the methane reacts with ozone, that is O3, we get an aldehyde and water. So these are all formed during the photochemical smog. Fine. They cause serious health problems. And ozone and PAN together form eye irritation. They are eye irritants. Fine. And this ozone and nitric oxide cause nose and throat problems, headaches, chest pain, dryness of throat, cough, and difficulty in breathing as well. You know how dangerous all these are, right? And it causes cracking of rubber, and it causes extensive damage to plant life, and it also causes corrosion of metals, stones, and building materials. Next, we will discuss about the stratospheric pollution. Fine. Formation and breakdown of ozone. We discussed when we were talking about stratosphere, we discussed that stratosphere has a layer of ozone, right? Ozone is nothing but O3. And now we'll see how ozone is formed and how it breaks down. Fine. So when UV radiations from the sun strikes the O2 molecule, it reacts with oxygen atom and forms O3, that is ozone. So this is how ozone is formed. And this ozone, O3 molecule, is highly unstable. So what happens is it breaks down into the respective components, that is O2 molecule and O, oxygen atom. Fine. And this ozone is what prevents the UV radiations from reaching the Earth's surface. And you know how harmful UV radiations are for us? It causes skin cancer and many such, side effects it has. So skin cancer is one of the main problems ozone causes to human beings. Fine. So this ozone layer is very important, and recently there has been a depletion in the ozone layer. That is, there has been a hole forming in the ozone layer, and this might be due to a lot of reasons, and the main contributor is the chlorofluorocarbon, that is CFCs. And this is what happens, and the chlorine in this reaction, the chlorine radicals get regenerated, fine, and they are continuously regenerated, and these chlorine radicals cause the breakdown of ozone. And these chlorine radicals are got from chlorofluorocarbon, right? CF2Cl2, fine, that is nothing but chlorofluorocarbon, and it generates chlorine free radical, and they are continuously regenerated, and this is what breaks the ozone layer and forms the ozone hole. This is a depiction of the size of the ozone hole over the years, and interestingly in 2019 it was little less compared to the other years. Fine. And this is how ozone hole mainly happens, because of all this reaction, and at the end a molecule of chlorine is split into two chlorine free radicals, and this chlorine radicals thus formed initiate the chain reaction for ozone depletion. And this is how ozone gets depleted, and if there forms a hole in the ozone layer, it is going to be very dangerous for us. It not only causes skin cancer, it has other side effects as well, right? So it is very advised to not use, you know, products having chlorofluorocarbon and whatever, which causes the depletion in the ozone hole. Fine. So we have to protect the ozone layer, and it's high time we do that. Fine. So this is all about stratospheric pollution. So now we have discussed about the atmospheric pollution, which consists of tropospheric pollution and stratospheric pollution as well. Fine. Next, let us discuss about water pollution. right? You will have a basic idea of water pollution, right? When the water is being polluted by some pollutants. So the pollutants may be various, like pathogens or organic wastes. And there are many sources from which the water gets polluted, as shown in the first image. And the main pollutants may be pathogens. In case of pathogens, you know, this disease-causing pathogens are usually from, you know, sewage or human and animal excreta. These all get into water and pollute the water. Fine, this is very disease-causing and it is harmful as well. And the other pollutants are organic waste. Organic waste, like, these are biodegradable, right? Organic waste may be something like grass, leaves, etc. All this pollute the water as well. And usually, to break down this organic waste, what happens is, microorganisms like bacteria and all, usually bacteria breaks down the organic waste in the water by consuming some oxygen from the water. So the oxygen content in the water goes down, right? So this is, there's a term known as biological oxygen demand, which basically means the bacteria is present in the water consume the oxygen to break down the organic waste or organic matter. And the amount of oxygen required is known as the biological oxygen demand. And in case of pathogens also, they are disease causing and they are all microorganisms like bacteria and all, which are basically from sewage or animal and human excreta, which pollute the water. So these are the two main sources of water pollution. Fine. And there are international standards for drinking water. To see to that the water is not polluted, we have some international standards. Fine. In case of fluoride, for drinking purposes, water should be tested for fluoride ion concentration. Fine. And its deficiency in water is harmful to man and causes decreases such as tooth decay and all. So fluoride deficiency will cause tooth decay and hence it's harmful, right? So we have to see to it there's a proper limit of fluoride contained in the drinking water. So the limit, so soluble fluoride is often added to drinking water to bring its concentration up to 1 ppm. 1 ppm, up to 1 ppm is the limit of the fluoride concentration in drinking water. Fine. Moving ahead, the next chemical is lead. So drinking water gets contaminated with lead when the lead pipes, right, when the pipes made up out of lead are used for transportation of water. So what happens when the drinking water gets transported to through lead pipes, this lead, the element lead, gets inside the water and hence the water gets contaminated. Fine. So the prescribed upper limit, that is the maximum concentration of lead in drinking water, is 50 ppb. Ppb is parts per billion. Ppm is parts per million. Fine. The next one is sulfate. Excessive sulfate, that is more than 500 ppm. So 500 ppm is the limit, we can say. Excessive sulfate in drinking water causes lactative effect. So this lead, no, excessive lead also can lead to, you know, kidney problems as such. And excessive sulfate leads to laxative effect. Fine. And then comes the nitrate. The maximum limit of nitrate in drinking water is 50 ppm. So this is the maximum limit that should be followed to check the nitrate in the drinking water. And excessive nitrate can cause something like blue baby syndrome. You look up for it. Fine. This is about the water pollution and the limits of the chemicals to be present in drinking water to make the water, drinking water, fit for drinking. Fine. So this is the basic about water pollutions in this chapter. Moving ahead. Now we shall discuss about the soil pollution. Fine. We have some idea about soil pollution, right? You see a lot of wastes out of your house itself every now and then. Fine. You know, we know how soil, that the land is getting polluted each and every day. There has been an increase, continuous increase in the pollution of land. Fine. So the soil pollution, there are three different types. The first one may be because of the pesticides. You know, pesticides contain dichloro, diphenyl, chloroethene. And these pesticides are sprayed onto plants so that the pests don't come and stick around the plants, right? So they're trying to protect the plants, but they're actually polluting the soil, the pesticides containing DDT chemical. Fine. And nowadays, these pesticides have been replaced by something known as herbicides, like sodium chlorate, sodium arsenide. These are the herbicides which are replacing the pesticides these days. But although these herbicides are also toxic to mammals, this is what they have found out recently. Fine. And not only pesticides and herbicides, there are a lot of industrial wastes contributing to the soil pollution. You know, there are plenty of waste from the industries, right? There are like hundreds, thousands of industries all over the world. and every day they are generating lot and lots of waste. Where are they dumping this waste, right? They have like enormous amount of waste even per day, and they're just dumping it somewhere, right? It is causing the soil pollution, right? And it can be any industry like steel, iron, it can be variable, and it's not degradable also. All these, you know, chemicals or waste from the industries, they're not degradable. So there are, these are the major contributions for the soil pollutions, like pesticides containing chemicals like DDT. It causes the pollution to the soil, and then herbicides also. These are toxic to mammals as well. And then comes the industrial waste. Fine, these are all the soil causes of the soil pollution. And now they are coming up with new strategies to control environmental pollution. So there are plenty of new various strategies come up now, by now. And the one way we can say to maintain, to control the waste management, what we can do is the segregation of waste, right? You can, the waste, everyday waste, if you segregate it and dispose it properly to wherever it can be disposed, we can collectively manage the waste, right? And there can be less soil pollution or whatever, water pollution as well. So when you put the particular, when you segregate the waste and put it in the particular bin, and then they'll dispose it in a systematic manner, and that is how we can control it to some extent, right? And the next thing, which is very important right now, is reuse, reduce, and recycle. These are the three R's. So keep on reusing things until and unless you can. And then reduce the use of plastics and such materials which are toxic to the environment, right? And then keep on recycling as well. So that all these, you know, these measures should come from within, right? From every individual. Only then we can, you know, bring a change in a bigger world, fine? And these are few strategies, few main strategies to control the environmental pollution. Next, green chemistry. This is something recent, and green chemistry is coming up, you know, with various ideas or researches so that they can reduce the they can have minimal effects on environment. Like it's reducing pollution or something. They're coming up with various ideas, you know, they're coming up with researches. So that whatever they come up with has less impact on the environment, fine? So they're coming up with sustainable products and all. So these are few things like what green chemistry focuses on. It forms safer chemical design, energy efficiency, reduction of derivatives. It can be used in catalysis recently. It prevents accidents. And green chemistry as a whole has like green catalysts, green solvents, and there are various ways how green chemistry is coming up these days. Next, we'll discuss about the green chemistry in day-to-day life. We'll see how these green chemistry have come up with new methods to replace the older methods so that they have less harmful effects on the environment, fine, so that they're less toxic to the environment, right? The first one is dry cleaning of clothes. Earlier, for the dry cleaning of clothes, they use something known as tetrachloroethene. And this tetrachloroethene used to contaminate groundwater, and it was carcinogenic as well. That is, it causes cancer. So now, after green chemistry, they came up with a new method to replace this tetrachloroethene by H2O2, that is hydrogen peroxide. It consumes less water also, and it is being more effective. It is not toxic at all. And even not only for the dry cleaning of clothes, hydrogen peroxide has replaced chlorine gas for the bleaching of paper as well. Earlier, for the bleaching of paper, they used to use chlorine gas. Fine. Now, hydrogen peroxide has replaced chlorine gas, and it is more effective and less toxic again. Fine. The next one is for the synthesis of chemicals. Nowadays, they are making lot of researches and reactions wherein they use green chemistry as catalyst for reactions. Fine. And in one particular reaction, they have synthesized ethanol, that is CH3CH4, aldehyde ethanol, using a catalyst from green chemistry, and the yield was almost like 90%. And this was one successful reaction, fine. And the other one was to clean turbid water. You know, all this municipality and industrial waste is present in the water, right? Municipality waste, industrial waste is present in the water, and the water gets polluted, right? To clean the turbidity of this water, they come up with a new method wherein they use the powder of kernels of tamarind seeds. And this is used to clean the turbid water. Usually what happens, you know, these kernels of tamarind seeds are usually thrown away, thinking it's an agricultural waste. But now they've come up with this new method where it can be the powders of these kernels of tamarind seeds can be used to clean turbid water. And this is what the green chemistry has been contributing to everyday life. And hence there is coming enormous amount of researches have been coming up in the field of green chemistry to substitute all these, you know, toxic components present so that it becomes less toxic to the environment. And so this is all about the environmental chemistry and the pollutions, environmental chemistry and the pollutions to the environment. And thank you for watching this video. And if you're liking this course, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe to Read My Course. Thank you.